sex has become relegated to a base animal instinct which, amongst consenting adults, has no limitations attached to it. And sexual behavior has become divorced from objective morality. Now, that is the culture and the context in which we live. And if you don't think it's like that, you're really not in touch with what is going on.
Take a look around, it seems like we're all the same. We've got headphones screaming in our ears and we're all scared of climate change. So I'm a sheep and I have gone astray. And what I really want is you, you. See at all, I choose to follow you, my Lord, my treasure. And of all that I had in this world, we're one day caught up in a blaze. Could I be thankful even then that you gave me? Took away. Love cost you more than I could ever know. But it's the only thing that's true, true. Cause you are my light and you are my treasure. You've called, you've chosen, I'm yours forever. When I can see clearly or can't see at all,
Bible with you this morning. I'm going to read from Exodus chapter 20. Exodus chapter 20, and if you have been with us on the last few weeks, you will know that we are looking at the Ten Commandments that God gave to Moses on Mount Sinai. We're not looking at them all one by one. We've tried to draw out some of the key principles and issues, I want to read from verse 1 this morning, just to remind ourselves of who is speaking when we consider the Ten Commandments. Exodus 20 verse 1 says, "And God spoke all these words, 'I am the Lord your God who brought you out of Egypt, out of the land of slavery.'" Then verse 14, "You shall not commit adultery." Verse 17, "You shall not covet your neighbor's house. You shall not covet your neighbor's wife." We've been looking at some of these commandments, and many of them, of course, are not controversial or counterculture to us. You shall not murder. We're all agreed about that, especially in the narrow sense of putting a knife into somebody's back or a bullet between their eyes. We're a little uncertain about abortion and euthanasia in our society. Does that fit into this? You shall not steal. We're all pretty well agreed about that. You shall not give false testimony against your neighbor. Most of us are agreed about that. But there are some controversial commandments amongst them that don't sit comfortably in our society today. For an example, "You shall have no other gods before me." One of the reasons why the Ten Commandments are no longer read in our schools is because we live in a pluralistic society, not just ethnically, but also religiously. We're glad about the ethnic pluralism. It's one of the things we love about this city. But religiously, how dare we give privileged status to the Christian God of Israel? And so the idea "you'll have no other gods before me" is certainly not in vogue generally in our society. "You should not make for yourselves an idol in any form." Well, the word "idol" has become quite respectable, you know, and many of you have watched Canadian Idol, and we don't even notice it. But idolatry is forbidden of any kind. But here's a controversial one. So one I've read from verse 14, "You shall not commit adultery." And I want to talk to you this morning about the sacredness of sex against the background of this command. Now, in the past 50 years, we have seen a sexual revolution that has completely changed the general view of sexual morality in the Western world, although it is wider than simply that. In North America, it's generally regarded as having begun with Alfred Kinsey when he produced the Kinsey Report, initially 1948, and then a second edition, 1953. In which he engaged in a study on human sexuality in America. Now, he based his report on interviews with 17,000 men and women in discussing their sex lives, and no survey of this kind had ever been conducted before. And previously, things that had been private and secret were brought out of the closet into public domain. Now, Kinsey reported that 50% of men had been unfaithful to their wives and 25% of women had been unfaithful to their husbands. He reported that homosexuality was much more common than had been believed. In 1953, Playboy was first published with its blatant exploitation of women as sex objects. The 60s gave great impetus to the sexual revolution. With the availability of the contraceptive pill, it became available in the end of the 50s, but it gave the idea of sex without consequences, and then we introduced abortion for those who didn't get it right first time, and you can get rid of the fetus later. And the baby boom generation, so-called the post-war generation, saw a revolution of attitude to sex through the media, through music, and through morality. I read just the other day, I've forgotten who it is, but some well-known leader of the past about a century ago said, "I don't care who writes the laws, but I do care who writes the music." Very perceptive insight, because music actually is much more influential than the laws that may exist in our nation. And especially so today, where music is available to us at the press of a button. And that's recent, of course, in the last couple of generations. Prior to that, you had to go to concerts to find music. And the morality of so much popular music has helped to change the whole perception on sex and its role. In 1966, possibly one of the most influential books of the 20th century was published. It was written by Joseph Fletcher. It was called Situation Ethics. He was a professor, one of the big universities. And Fletcher's basic principle is that nothing is universally right or wrong. Nothing is intrinsically good or intrinsically bad. He said, good and bad are things which happen to actions in different situations. So in one situation, something is good. In another situation, it's bad. Hence, the title of his book, Situation Ethics. The one thing, said Fletcher, that is intrinsically good is love. And so love must be the motivation in things that you do. And this, of course, became a watchword, especially in the second part of the 1960s. The whole hippie movement was based on this philosophy. The all-important thing is love. The Beatles sang a song, "All You Need Is Love." Then they broke up, by the way, soon after. And the intervening years, this has become increasingly the norm. Anybody under 40, probably any of you under 40 here today, wonder, I didn't know that was new. Because this idea is so ingrained. But it gave a rationale for divorcing behavior from any objective criteria and instead freed us up to measure our behavior by subjective criteria, that is, to our own internal sense. Initially, love, Fletcher emphasized, was the criteria. His book says you can't just live as you please. It has to be motivated by love. But in the course of time, even that becomes increasingly weakened to basically it's based on love for myself. What pleases me is valid. And at its worst case scenario, sex has become relegated to a base animal instinct, which amongst consenting adults has no limitations attached to it. And sexual behavior has become divorced from objective morality. Now, that is the culture and the context in which we live. And if you don't think it's like that, you're really not in touch with what is going on. Now, into this situation, the timeless, eternal God speaks in Exodus 20, and amongst other things, he says, "You shall not commit adultery," and the variety of sexual sin which is inherent within that instruction. And we ask the question this morning, how does this commandment fit into the sexually liberated society whose norms and expectations are so radically different from the time in which this commandment was given? True, of course, our sex drive is good. It is necessarily powerful. Marketers know that. That's why sexual stimulation is a constant in the marketing world. And it sells everything from cars to toothpaste. But more blatantly than that, of course, is the availability of pornography. Do you know there are as many pornographic bookstores, video stores, as there are McDonald's outlets in North America? I know McDonald's tend to be on the main street. The porn shops tend to be down the back streets, or they were, less so. Increasingly, they're becoming bolder and more frontline. And the access through the internet that has become a snare for so very many, many people today. Now, let me talk about two things in relation to all of this. First of all, let me talk about what's good about sex. And then what is the problem with sex is the second thing I want to talk about. And I want in the first instance to understand the teaching about this in the five books of Moses. It's always good, certainly as a starting point, to interpret Scripture in its immediate context. And then, of course, we can spread more widely. But what's good about sex? Let me give you four good things that the law of Moses addresses about sex, first of all, about marriage, secondly, about women, thirdly, and I'll explain why I'm singling out women for mention here, and fourthly, about children. First of all, sex is a divine blessing. Now, back in creation, the first thing God ever said to mankind in Genesis 1:28 was this: God blessed them and said to them, "Be fruitful and increase in number." Did you realize that the first command God gave to humanity was to engage in sexual intercourse? On man's job description, this is the first bullet point. Be fruitful and multiply. Under God's instruction. This is before the fall. God pronounced it along with everything else in creation. His intense satisfaction when he saw all that he had made and it was very good. Later, God called Abraham, and God set Abraham apart primarily to be the father of a nation. God promised him a son, from this son a family, and from that family would come a nation. And God's promises were centered on Abraham's descendants, his seed, as it was described. And from this nation, said God, the world is going to be blessed. And then God gave to Abraham a mark of the covenant, a mark of the agreement that he'd made with him. And the mark of the covenant was circumcision. That is the marking of the male sex organ. Now, why in the world is circumcision the mark of the covenant God made with Abraham? Why not pierce your ear? It's a little more pleasant and a little evident to anybody who's interested to know if you've got the sign of the covenant, or put a stud in your nose. Why circumcision? I'll tell you why. Because the whole purpose God set Abraham apart was that he would father a nation, and it was the destiny of the nation that would come from his body, and the children and grandchildren and descendants that were the purpose. And so God marked off Abraham's sexuality as sacred to the covenant. That's why circumcision is the mark of the nation of Israel and the covenant God made with Abraham. Because he was marking the sacredness of the sex act. Now, this became redundant after Christ. Because as Paul explains in Galatians chapter 3, the book of Galatians, you may know, was written to affirm that circumcision was no longer necessary. There were those who were saying to become a Christian, you've got first to become a Jew. To become a Jew, you have to be circumcised. And Paul wrote the letter to Galatians to explain that that was not necessary. And part of his argument is this, Galatians 3:16, the promises were spoken to Abraham and to his seed. The scripture, says Paul, the scripture does not say and to seeds, meaning many people, but and to your seed, meaning one person who is Christ. Now he says the promise of God was that through the nation would come the seed of Abraham, which was Christ. Now that Christ has come, the covenant has been fulfilled. No longer need you set apart as sacred through circumcision the act of sex in that sense for the nation of Israel. The point I'm making to you this morning is the sacredness of sex in the Old Testament covenant. Sex is a divine blessing. God declared it so. Secondly, marriage is a divine blessing. Now, God ordained marriage in the Garden of Eden. And there were three reasons. The first reason was for companionship. Genesis chapter 2, verse 18, it says, the Lord God said, it's not good for man to be alone. I'll make a helper suitable for him. This was the first issue, the first reason for marriage, the need for companionship. It's not good for us to be alone. We were made for fellowship and the most intimate relationship that God ordained for friendship and companionship was marriage. The second reason for marriage was the sexual relationship. Now, this is implicit in the command to procreate, but in the New Testament, Paul says there are some good reasons for remaining single, but the sex drive is not one of the reasons for remaining single. In 1 Corinthians 7 and verse 8, he says, "Now to the unmarried and the widows, I say, it's good for them to remain unmarried as I am. But if they cannot control themselves, they should marry, for it is better to marry than to burn with passion." So Paul says, if you cannot control yourself, get married. It's better to do that than to burn with passion. And so he is saying there that the sexual relationship is a reason for marriage. Philip Yancey says in one of his books that God uses sex to lure us, he says, into a relationship that offers to teach us what we most need to know, which is sacrificial love. He says you're attracted by the sexual relationship and you come into the marriage and you discover you don't spend your life in bed. You discover that it involves sacrificial loving and giving for better, for worse, for richer, for poorer, and the rest of it. But this is the magnet which God sucks us into that relationship, says says Philip Yancey. Very clever. And of course, the rest of the Old Testament is explicit about, or in the rest of the Old Testament, there are cases of being explicit about the enjoyment of sex and marriage. The Song of Solomon is a beautiful picture of two lovers, and it's quite explicit at times. In the book of Proverbs, the writer says, "May your fountain be blessed, may you rejoice in the wife of your youth, a loving doe, a graceful deer, may her breasts satisfy you always, may you ever be captivated by her love." Very explicitly there, it talks about enjoying the sexual relationship in marriage. Third reason for marriage is for procreation, that is, for the bringing of children into the world. Now, I already read Genesis 1:28. God blessed them and said, "Be fruitful and increase in number." And the sexual relationship is the means by which children are to be brought into the world. So there are three reasons for marriage in the early part of the scripture: companionship, the sexual relationship, and procreation. And I have deliberately placed the sexual relationship in the middle of those three because it feeds both. It is the sexual relationship which feeds and nurtures and deepens the companionship. Of course, it's companionship also which gives meaning to the sexual relationship. That is more particularly so for the woman than for the man, where it's the meaning of the relationship that gives the sex act its significance. Men can get by without it sometimes, but not so women in the same way. But also it is the sexual relationship which is designed to bring children, as well as to nurture and deepen the relationship. And both are contributed to by the sexual relationship. So if sex is a divine blessing, marriage is a divine blessing, thirdly, women are a blessing. The reason why I identify that is because the law of Moses has a lot to say about the protection of women. In some cultures, there is a perception that sex is a male activity. Women are simply the passive participants. But the expectation of enjoyment and meaning and satisfaction is limited. That is not how the scripture understands the sexual relationship. The law of Moses is very protective of women, not only in the heavy penalties for the sexual abuse of women, but also in protecting women sexually within the marriage. You see, the book of Leviticus in particular talks about women at certain times being unclean, is the language that is used. Now, the word unclean carries to us a connotation of being dirty. I don't think that is helpful to us. I think the meaning of unclean is off limits. There are certain times, Leviticus says, a woman is off limits for her protection during her monthly period. After the birth of a child is specified in Leviticus 12, it says a woman is to be protected from sexual intercourse after giving birth for 40 days if it's a son, 80 days if it's a daughter. I personally am not sure why that difference is there. I don't know enough about gynecology, but you can be sure there's probably a good reason. Certainly to enable her to heal before renewed sexual activity. And Leviticus protects women in that relationship in marriage. So women are a blessing. Fourthly, children are a blessing. Now, in the Old Testament nation of Israel, as I've already implied, having children carries special significance because the whole purpose of the nation was to bring the seed of Abraham. Therefore, barrenness, that is, the inability of a woman to conceive, was a particular cause for dismay and sadness and disappointment. Not simply in the general sense of that may be so to any woman who is unable to conceive a child, but because it meant that the woman was not able to participate in the destiny of the nation. That's why Israel had been set apart as a nation. And you'll find in the Old Testament every attempt was made to conceive, including prayer and intercession that God would give a child. There's also the use of fertility herbs in the Old Testament scriptures. In Genesis 30, you have a very interesting story of a squabble between Leah and Rachel, the two wives of Jacob. Now, Rachel, you may remember, had no children at this stage. Leah had several. And they had a squabble over some mandrakes, which Leah's son Reuben had found outside and brought into the house. Now, mandrakes were a small fruit about the size of a plum. And Rachel asked Leah for some of her son's mandrakes. And Leah's response is a surprising one. She said, "Wasn't it enough that you took my husband and now you want my mandrakes as well?" Well, why does she associate the fact that you're the second wife, although the most loved wife of Jacob, but you took my husband, now you want my plums, my grapes, whatever else this mandrakes look like as well. Why does she associate her taking the husband with taking the mandrakes? Well, the reason is because the mandrakes were regarded as being a fertility fruit or herb. In fact, amongst the Arab peoples today, it is still a means of promoting childbearing. In fact, they're known in the Arab world as love apples. And so these mandrakes were an issue between Rachel and Leah because Rachel was asking for a fertility drug, herb, whatever you want to associate it as being, to help her in bearing children. Because having children was necessary to participating in the destiny that God had set the nation apart for, to bring the seed of Abraham. Now, of course, children are still a blessing from God, and those of us who are parents thank God for the privilege of that. But God's purposes are not tied to our having children in the way they were for Israel. There was divine significance to barrenness in Israel. That's why God frequently intervened in the lives of barren women to bring about the birth of a child. That was true for Sarah in the birth of Isaac. It was true for Rebekah in the birth of Jacob and Esau. It was true for Samson's mother in the birth of Samson. It was true for Hannah in the birth of Samuel. It was true for Elizabeth in the birth of John the Baptist. Because having children were necessary if they're to participate in the destiny of the nation. So that's what's good about sex. Right through the Old Testament, sex is healthy and good and knows the blessing of God, not just on the sex act, but on marriage, on women, and on children. My second point is then, what is the problem with sex? Well, very clearly, that which has potential for so much good also has within it the potential for so much hurt and so much problem. You know, it's interesting that every society has laws regulating sexual behavior of some kind or other. And here God says to Moses, "You shall not commit adultery." And in the law of Moses, which amplifies these Ten Commandments, there is a range of sexual activities that are forbidden. And I'm not going to speak about them all this morning. I haven't got time to do so, but I'll just point out to them the ones that I can find that are specified. Fornication, that is premarital sex. Adultery, that of course is specifically commanded here, extramarital sex. Incest, sexual relationship within family. Homosexuality, between two of the same sex. Bestiality, involving animals. Forced sexual activity, primarily rape, but not only rape. Seduction is criticized heavily, especially a man who seduces a virgin. These are all in the law of Moses. Now, the commandment we're looking at is you shall not commit adultery. And to handle this properly in the time I have this morning, I want to talk about, I'm going to limit this to consensual sexual activity in two areas. Fornication, first of all, and adultery, secondly. Now, fornication, by definition, is premarital sex. It ranges from, on the one hand, casual sex, to, on the other hand, living together outside of marriage. Both of these have become quite normative in our society, but both of them are included in this word fornication. Now, what is the big idea about marriage? I have heard it said and had it said to me, and you probably heard it said, it's just a piece of paper. What's the big deal? Does legal recognition in any way alter substantially the relationship? These are genuine questions. They're good questions that people ask. And I've been asked these questions, as you've probably heard them as well. Did Adam marry Eve? What about Isaac taking Rebekah into his tent and she became his wife? Well, every society has different customs and legal arrangements relating to marriage, but the principle does exist in nearly every society. In Hebrew society of the Old Testament, marriage involved three elements. There was, first of all, the commitment of a man to a woman, that they would marry each other. We have an equivalent, we call it engagement. By the time you get to the New Testament, it was much more firm than that. We know that Mary was betrothed to Joseph. That meant that they were in a legally binding commitment, which could only be broken by divorce, but they had not yet had sexual relationships because the betrothal period was a legally binding relationship, but not yet consummated. Well, there was that first period, the commitment of a man to a woman to marry them. Secondly, there was the public expression of that commitment to the wider community in some public ceremony, in the Old Testament, lasting several days very often. Then the third element was the consummation of that commitment in the sex act. That followed the public commitment in marriage. You see, marriage is more than just consensual sex with government approval. That is a pretty crude way to understand it. It's far more than that. In the scriptures, marriage is a full, unconditional surrender of each to the other. Let me read you what Paul wrote in the New Testament. In 1 Corinthians chapter 7 and verse 3, he said, "The husband shall fulfill his marital duty to his wife, and likewise the wife to her husband." Let me just pause there. That is, that the husband has a sexual obligation and a sexual responsibility to his wife, as she has also to her husband. Now, why? He says in verse 4, "The wife's body does not belong to her alone, but also to her husband." It does belong to her, but not her alone. It also belongs to her husband. In the same way, the husband's body does not belong to him alone, but also to his wife. And by the way, the argument, it's her body, breaks down in marriage. It's also his body. And his is also hers. And then Paul says, "Don't deprive each other except by mutual consent, and for a time that you may devote yourselves to prayer, then come together again that Satan will not tempt you because of your lack of self-control." Now, the context for the sexual relationship that Paul is teaching there is that you belong to each other. You are not your own. You belong to each other, not simply your own. Outside of marriage, you do not belong to the other person. You may loan yourself to the other person, but you do not belong to the other person. And the wedding ceremony is a public surrender of each to the other, that you belong emotionally, you commit yourself to love each other in sickness and in health, for better, for worse, for richer, for poorer, etc. You belong volitionally, you made a declaration, I will love her. By the way, you're not asked the question, do you love? And the answer is not, I do. If that was the question, and do you love this woman? And you say, I do. 6 months later or 10 years later, you could say, well, I did when I said I do, but I don't anymore. But that's not the question. The question is, will you love this woman? Will you take this man? And you say, I will. You're saying that volitionally, with my will, I am committing myself to this person. Well, supposing you say, as has been said to me before, I didn't know what she was like until 6 months later. Well, the fool you are for not knowing what she's like. Make sure you find out what she's like and what he's like. But you've made a commitment, and your integrity stands on that commitment. Volitionally, your will is surrendered to each other. And you belong not just emotionally and volitionally, you belong legally. And the legal aspect is important. Not least because as Christians, we are to live according to the laws of our lands that we are part of. Unless they violate the law of God. But you see, outside of marriage, you do not belong. And statistics on cohabiting couples in North America indicate that only one couple in six is still together after 3 years. Only one couple in 10 is together after 5 years. And statistics show that cohabiting couples are less happy than married couples, less faithfully sexually, and financially worse off. And those who do marry after a period of cohabiting are also more likely to end up with divorce. A Chicago sociologist, Linda Waite, has written a paper in which she shows how cohabitation encourages individualistic behavior instead of relationship where the two, I'm adding this, she didn't say this because this is the scriptural picture, where the two become one. But in a cohabiting relationship, the two remain two. You can give yourself to each other. You can enjoy each other. But you've not been merged into a new unit. That's why a wedding is a public before society declaration that I now belong to this man and to this woman, and thereafter we share the same address and usually share the same name, though that is not necessary, nor is it universal. But when we do, it's symptomatic of that oneness. Now, statistics indicate to us that people born after the mid-60s, anybody under 40, is wary of long-term commitments. And that applies to all sorts of things, and it applies to marriage, and it applies to relationship. But I want to say this, if you're a Christian this morning, you've got to rid yourself of the cynicism that says, I cannot stand with a commitment. Because God calls us to commit. And if there are those of us here this morning, and you're a Christian, by being a Christian, what you mean is that you are seeking to live your life under the authority of Jesus Christ and under the authority of His Word. That's what it means to be a Christian. And yet you are living in a cohabiting relationship with someone to whom you're not yet married. You need to hear this unambiguously, that living together outside of marriage is wrong. And I want to suggest you do three things. I suggest if that's your situation, that you separate your living arrangements. And along with that, you apologize to each other. And that you plan a wedding day. And you get married and enjoy marriage as God intended it to be. Now, I've heard the argument, it's cheaper to live together than apart and all that kind of stuff. But let me tell you, it is worth the extra dollars to live separately and to do it right before God and lay a foundation that God will bless in years to come. That's fornication, premarital sexual relationship. Second, let me talk about adultery, which this command specifically addresses, which is extramarital sex. By definition, adultery is a sexual relationship between two people where at least one of them is married to somebody else. Now, Scripture is constant right the way through in its condemnation of adultery, and I'll give you four reasons. Firstly, it is destructive of the individual. That is, the person who engages in adultery. In Proverbs chapter 6 and verse 32, it says, "A man who commits adultery lacks judgment. Whoever does so destroys himself." That's not speaking about his marriage, his family, and so on. He destroys himself. In 1 Corinthians 6 and verse 18, Paul says, "Flee from sexual immorality." Now listen to this. "All other sins a man commits are outside his body. But he who sins sexually sins against his own body." Now people will say, sexual sin is no different to any other sin. That is not true. Sexual sin is different to every other sin, Paul says, because that is a sin against your own body. And then he says, having said that, "Do you not know that your body is a temple of the Holy Spirit who is in you, who you have received from God? You're not your own. You're bought with a price. Therefore, honor God with your body." And we often quote that latter part, your body is a temple of the Holy Spirit, and honor God with your body. But the context in which Paul writes that is he's saying flee sexual immorality because you sin against your own body. And therefore, firstly, adultery is destructive of the individual. Secondly, it is destructive of marriage. It is so destructive of marriage that adultery is the only grounds in which Jesus concedes divorce in his teaching in the Gospels. Now, that needs qualifying, I suspect. It's not that adultery is the reason for the divorce, but that the act of the adultery is itself the destruction of the marriage bond. Don't ever say, "She divorced me, but it's you who committed adultery." That is the cheapest trick in the book. You broke the marriage. And therefore, divorce conceded by Jesus in that situation is the recognition that you have violated your commitment, you have violated your promise that you made, and you've reneged on your word. Adultery is destructive of the marriage. Thirdly, it is destructive of the family. Many families have been broken through adultery. Many children have known the consequences of their parents' adultery or one of their parents' adultery and the breakup of the marriage and the lack of trust if the marriage stays together then exists within the family. And children live with the consequences. As a teacher once said to me, we talk about problem children, but we don't actually have problem children in our school. We have problem parents at home. Now, there are different reasons why marriages break up. We need to deal with this with the greatest tenderness and sympathy and mercy. But I'm talking about adultery and why adultery is so constantly forbidden in Scripture. It's destructive of the family, and fourthly, it is destructive of society. Some years ago, a researcher published a book on the decline and fall of the 27 major civilizations of history. I believe it was Will Durant. Will Durant wrote a book, The Story of Civilization. He was a historian and a philosopher. He died in 1981. But in his examination of the 27 civilizations of history, he wrote a universally common factor in their decline and fall was the disintegration of sexual morality. And he says, I cannot explain this fact. I am merely observing that it was so. But I think when we begin to think about it, it becomes fairly obvious why it is so. If adultery destroys the individual, and adultery destroys marriage, and adultery destroys the family, inevitably it will be destructive in society. Because the family is the building block of society. I want to quote you from an article in Reader's Digest by a man called Lin Tain Yee. It's about his father. And he makes this observation. It has seemed to me that the final test of any civilization is what type of husbands and wives and fathers and mothers does it turn out? Every other achievement of civilization, art, philosophy, literature, and material living pales into insignificance. The family has been an important part of Western civilization, indeed of all civilizations, and of primitive cultures too. The family provides meaning, continuity, and purpose in the lives of individuals. It provides a nurturing and protective environment in which children can progress to adulthood, and the best environment for the care of the aged, the disabled, and the young. There is no engine of progress, security, and social advancement as powerful as the family. There is no instrument of economic growth, savings and investment, job creation and job training as effective as the functioning family. There is no cultural institution as ennobling as family life. There is no better way to rear the young, to protect the weak, or to attend the elderly. None. Therefore, adultery, by being destructive of the family, becomes destructive of society as an inevitable domino knock-on effect. With it, of course, the absence of sexual restraint leads inevitably to the abuse of the dignity and the humanity of other people, especially women, the young, and the vulnerable who are taken advantage against. And I can add a fifth one. I said four, but I can add a fifth obvious one, that adultery is a sin against God. Do you know why? Because God himself is totally faithful, and he created us as his, as human beings, to be in his image, to portray his character, and therefore to be unfaithful is to turn our back on God himself. And I want to say to you, if you're serious in your Christian life, you must bring your sex life under the authority of Jesus Christ, and in so doing, under the enabling of the Holy Spirit. And if you're guilty of violating the sacredness of sex, if you're guilty of adultery here this morning, it's likely there are people here this morning and you've fallen in that area, I want to suggest you do three things. That you confess your sin before God, first of all. That you seek forgiveness from those you have sinned with and those you have sinned against. And thirdly, you do what is necessary to put it right. If you're in a relationship right now, you need to sever it. If you've been in one, you still need to clean it up in apology and confession. And you need to do it today. And some of you will need this afternoon to go home and begin to put this right. Let's pray together. Father, we thank you this morning that your word doesn't leave us fumbling in a fog, trying to find our way through a forest. We can't see anything. We don't know where we're going. Your word lays out for us a pathway in life which is not only designed to bring you glory, but in so doing, designed to bring us satisfaction and a sense of wholeness. I pray for any here this morning to whom the Holy Spirit has brought conviction. Thank you when you bring to us conviction, it's never to condemn us, it's never to rub our nose in our own dirt, it's always that you might cleanse us as we repent and confess, that you might renew us. And I pray, Lord Jesus, that those to whom you may have spoken will be courageous and bold and do what is necessary to restore honor and dignity to their own lives and to remove that barrier which will exist between them and you. Lord, have mercy on us. For those of us who are sitting here this morning and we don't want to know this and we don't want to hear this, we don't want to respond to this, we ask that in your tender mercy and love, you'll break through our stubbornness that we understand that our Creator designed us to function in a way that satisfies and meets the deep needs of our own hearts. Deliver us, Lord, from being broken through this and help us to respond to you. For we pray it in Jesus' name. Amen.
To watch this message again, go to our website, livingtruth.ca. You can also order DVDs and CDs, download transcripts, sign up for our monthly newsletter, check out the Living Truth Daily Devotional, sign up for podcasts, and read faith stories from other viewers. We love to hear from you, so send us your comments and testimonies. Living Truth is supported by viewers like you. Thank you for transforming lives through your financial participation. Tune in next week for the continuation in this series from Charles Price.
Judgment, so slow to see the good inside,
So take me, Lord, and teach me mercy. There are all your temples in the skies, and let me see your plan for me, my place despite calamity. Your will as I run for the prize. Oh, let me see the world through your eyes. For once my eyes are truly opened, and your glory fills my sight. I pray, oh Lord, won't you use me? Take my pride, take my fear, take my love. I run for